Hey guys, welcome to the Niobium Podcast, brought to you by CBMM, global leader in the production and commercialization of Niobium products around the world with more than 400 customers in more than 50 countries. So remember, as you see here in the podcast series, small amounts of Niobium can transform the properties of materials, and only small amount of time can transform your knowledge about material science. So I'm Mauricio, part of the CBMM team, and this is Kyle.
Hey guys, I'm Kyle. I'm the technical development manager for stainless steels here in CBMM as well.
So Kyle, this is the moment for us to talk about niobium enhancing the properties of the stainless steels. And by the way, guys, if you missed the first episode, there is a QR code here. Watch it and keep posted about the podcast series here. So Kyle, what can we talk about niobium enhancing the properties of stainless steel? As you know, in the metallurgy industry and the carbon steels, we talk much about grain refinement and grain boundaries. So is this something that also similar to the stainless steel industry?
Yeah, good point, man. I think that's the first thing that we can say. Niobium is a must for the stainless steel industry of the future. And actually, niobium will help a lot the stainless steel industry to achieve some of the sustainability targets that we are talking about. But I think that niobium, in certain way, can bring some of the properties that it brings to carbon steels, as you mentioned, enhancing mechanical properties. But remember that we have so many other elements in the alloy of stainless steels that we don't have in carbon steels. So in a certain way, it's similar, but in another way, it's completely different. And we are going to talk about some of these differences. I think this is exactly the point that we need to talk about to demystify what we talked in the first episode, that stainless is only for beautiful surfaces and corrosion resistance. We're going to talk about high temperature performances, for example.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about processes like welding, stamping, and things like that. We're going to talk about corrosion. We're going to talk about oxidation. So many things, man. So many things.
There's a lot of things for us to talk. So let's start and going straight to the point. But one question that I have, in the previous episode, we talked about FERRITIC and austenitic steels. Is niobium used in all of these five types of stainless steels, or is it works the same way in the different materials?
Good question. If we talk about niobium today, it's not used in all stainless steels. I would say that the majority of stainless steels that use niobium today, they are the FERRITICs, the 400 series. So if you remember the 441, the 444, 439, these materials, they have niobium in the chemical composition. Some austenitics, they do have niobium. They do have niobium, such as the 347, for example, a few other materials. Precipitation hardening materials, these materials that are used, for example, in operation equipment for surgery, they have niobium as well. Some martensitic materials, they have niobium. But I would say that the majority of them, they are in the ferritic families.
So, and what is the role of niobium in it?
Yeah.
How can we resume this?
Good question. I think that we need to first link the usage of niobium to the application of these materials. And one of the most important points that niobium will bring to some of these materials is the possibility of being used in very, very high temperatures.
Like, what is this temperature?
Yeah, in some cases, we are talking temperatures about 1,000 degrees Celsius.
Whoa.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that it's an important point because in a certain way, niobium is bringing similar properties as it brings to carbon steels. So for example, if you add a little bit of niobium stainless steels, you're going to have what we call enhancing your mechanical property by solid solution in high temperatures. If you guys want to know about solid solution, we also have very nice papers in niobium.
Thank you. Yeah. Here.
But that's not the point, because when we talk about high temperatures, and of course, this will depend about the material, this will depend about the temperature, but let's take this range of temperature that I said, close to 950, 1,000 degrees Celsius. When we expose materials to these temperatures, we're going to start having some phenomena happening in the microstructural level of the material. So if we manage to zoom in the material and we take a look in the microstructure when it's exposed to these very high temperatures, we're going to see the grains of the material will start sliding between one another. And the sliding of the grains will then lead to grain growth and the material will fail. We call this phenomena creep. It's basically the failure by its own weight when exposed to very high temperatures. So it's very interesting because when you add niobium to the material And you have to add niobium to a certain level that we call niobium in excess in these materials. Niobium will form some precipitates in these grain boundaries. We call these precipitates intermetallics, and in some cases they are also carbides. But if these intermetallics, if these particles that are precipitated in a grain boundary, they have a very high dissolution temperature, meaning that in these high temperatures they are not dissolved, they will hold the grain. So they will avoid the grain sliding happening, and then the material can be used in this very high temperature.
And what are the what is used like in this extreme high temperature?
That's the point. That's the point. When I'm talking about this, I'm talking to some applications that will be crucial to the future. So for example, when we talk about energy generation, boilers, some heat exchangers. When we talk, for example, about mobility, as you know very well, exhaust systems, they are still there. Mm-hmm. We're going to have the trends that we talked in the beginning of the podcast. We talked about the trend for electrification. And for example, in Europe, they just announced the banning of internal combustion engines by 2035. But until the transition happened, exhaust systems, they will still be there. And I don't know if everybody knows, but as high as you go in temperature in the exhaust system of your car, more efficient the cleaning of the gases will be. More efficiency the catalysis will be in your catalytic converter. So if you develop materials that can sustain temperatures above 1,000 degrees Celsius, that means that your car will have less emissions.
And then emissions is the core of all the debates that we have
around the
world, not only in Europe. So I think this is something that can relate also to the global industry.
Of course. So batteries will be there. Actually, if you guys don't know yet, we are developing also batteries with niobium. So again, access here the QR code so you'll be able to see some of our developments in this area. These will be some of the main core technologies of niobium in the future. But until then, exhaust systems, they need to be optimized. And the best way to optimize stainless steels will be by enhancing these temperatures in the exhaust systems. This is one point. When we talk about energy generation, we have, for example, a very big trend for the energetic transition. How can we produce more sustainable energy in the world? This is a must. We need to think about this as a society.
And we've seen lots of new ways to generate energy, like, and what is the core of the energy generation with the stainless steel, and how is it used? How is it the main differential for the?
It's a good question. Energy generation can be done by so many ways. The classical way, let's say like that, the conventional energy generation is produced by heating up water, and how you heat up water is the thing. You can heat up water with coal, gas, nuclear, but then you heat up water, you generate vapor, and this vapor will make a turbine roll, and then you generate electricity with that. But we need to think about new ways of generating electricity, like solar, wind, and we have some equipments that can generate electricity by fuel cells. So we have a very specific way of technology that's called solid oxide fuel cells. And they are a type of fuel cells that also operate in very high temperature. And what's the beauty of this fuel?
And the high temperature is like 1,000 degrees or so? Or
this is a little bit lower. We are talking between 600 degrees Celsius to 1,000 degrees Celsius. But what's the beauty of this technology? They can use hydrogen to generate electricity, but they can also use carbon monoxide to generate electricity. So if you find a way to capture carbon from the environment, you can use carbon to generate electricity. So that's a very good way of renewing your electricity and having more sustainable solutions. And stainless steels with niobium are allowing that.
Oh, this is so nice. This is so nice to see this, all this evolution in terms of the technology and how materials are playing a key role in it, and like especially niobium.
Yeah. I mean, if we talk about energy, we have so many areas where niobium is already being used with success, like nuclear power generation. Many things were discussed about nuclear in the past, but nuclear is gaining a lot of momentum once again with the complex situation that we are having in Europe, for example. So many new nuclear reactors are being developed. And I think that we have so many consolidated applications with niobium in stainless inside nuclear energy generation. We have stainless being used in high temperature performance in valves, for example, so precipitation hardening stainless steels. They are not using the same very high temperature range of 1,000 degrees. a little bit slower, a little bit lower, but they are also there. So I would say that for a high temperature performance, I would say mobility and our energy generation segments are the core ones.
When you talk about high temperatures, one thing that also comes to my mind is welding, because
we
know that this is one point that niobium plays a very important role in other industries when coming to the metallurgy as well. But is it also something that applies to the stainless steel industry? Is like a benefit? Does niobium play like any specific role in enhancing the welding capabilities and of the stainless steels?
Yes, very good point. And yes, the short answer is yes. And remember when you asked me in the first episode, the synergic role of niobium with other elements,
like
titanium, this is the point. Now, when we talk about welding, I think it's really important to consider two main problems. Because when we weld a material, we are basically joining two materials together, but we are also adding a defect between these two materials. It's a defected zone. So we need to reduce or mitigate as much as we can of the problems in this welded zone. And austenitic materials, the 300 series, for example, they weld very well. They are a very good material to be welded. But we can have a few problems when we weld or austenitic or ferritic materials.
Like what kind of problems?
Yeah, there's a problem that we call sensitization, which is basically the precipitation of chromium in the form of carbides. So basically, chromium will react with carbon and form a chromium carbide. And remember when I said in the first episode that stainless steels, they have the corrosion resistance because of this passive layer on the surface, that's a chromium oxide.
Mm-hmm.
Now imagine you have chromium being taken out of stainless steels and precipitate as a carbide. You don't have chromium anymore to form the passive layer.
So on one of the key points for us here is to demystify a little bit more about materials technology. And now we're talking about carbides and blah, blah, blah. So can you draw a little bit more like for our guys here who are listening to us? So what is the carbide that we're talking? Because I know that this is very deep in terms of content, but what is this microstructure of the
No, you're right. If we give a step back. So when we take a look in the microstructure of the material, let's imagine we have a microscope and we are giving a zoom in a sheet of stainless steel.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say we weld that. We're going to have the grain boundaries of the materials.
So the steel is composed of
grain.
Lots of things. Okay.
Depend on the type of steel, the type of grain will be different. But if we take a look in the material itself and we give a zoom in, we're going to see that the material is organized by grains.
And is this that is going to classify as an austenitic or ferritic? It's like the structure?
It's not this, but that's a good question. It's not this, but when you take a look in the grain structure of an austenitic material, it's going to be completely different than the grain structure of the ferritic material.
Okay.
So we can identify a material from the grain structure, but it's not what defines the material.
Okay.
So that's a very important point. But when we take a look in the grain boundaries of these materials, because if you take a look in the grain, we're going to have regions around the grains that doesn't have anything there. So those are exactly the regions where chromium will react with carbon and form these carbides.
Oh, okay.
So it's basically a precipitation. This is a precipitate that will happen there. And if you're removing chromium from the chemical composition of stainless and you are precipitating there, you no longer have corrosion resistance because chromium is not forming the passive layer. So you can have corrosion in your welded zone. Now guess who can save stainless?
Niobium.
Yeah.
Oh, I know that.
Niobium can basically react easier with carbon and nitrogen than chromium. So you're going to have precipitates. Instead of being chromium, you're going to have precipitates of niobium in this region. And chromium will be free to react and keep the passive layer stable and form in a very spontaneous way, avoiding corrosion resistance. This is a very specific type of corrosion. We call that intergranular corrosion. And adding niobium to your material, to the weldability, you are going to mitigate this problem.
Oh, this is nice.
Yeah.
This is nice, especially because we see that lots of this.
Yeah.
Applications are welded materials.
We have other points. Remember that I said that ferritic stainless steels, they are cheaper in average when compared to austenitic stainless steels?
Yes.
And one point that I also mentioned when I said that is that ferritic stainless steels, they are a little bit more complex to work. Not impossible, but they need to be worked or processed in a different way than austenitic stainless steels. This is crucial. And when we weld ferritic stainless steels, this material can suffer a phase transformation. In a certain moment, some ferritic stainless steels, if they have very high elements that stabilizes austenites, like carbon and nitrogen, for example, they can have a partial phase transformation from ferrite to austenite. So you're basically welding your material, increasing the temperature, and partially you can change the microstructure of your material from ferrite to austenite. And now imagine, you take out your welding because you finish your process, the material starts to cool down. What happens when austenite cools down? It quenches, it becomes martensite. I think you already heard about martensite.
Mind blowing.
No, it's a lot of technical terms, but guys, I think it's important that we have all of this in our technical library in Niobium Tech. Of course, we're going to make this material available to you. And again, if you have questions, even after...
Yeah, there is a contact here. So yeah, guys, feel free to contact
Get in us. Touch with us. That's our job. We need to talk more about this. We want to talk about Niobium. But this happens because when you increase the temperature, you have an instability of the ferritic phase. And remember, again, in the first episode, I said there are some elements that stabilize austenite and some elements that stabilize ferrite. And once again, who can save the stability of the ferritic material?
Oh, let me think here. Niobium.
Of course, niobium, man. Of course. If you add niobium in the chemical composition of ferritic stainless steels, you're going to see that the stability of the ferritic phase is enhanced. Of course, there are some elements that you also need to control, for example, carbon and nitrogen. So you need to reduce these elements and add a little bit more of niobium. And then when you weld your material, you don't have this phase transformation and you don't have embrittlement of your welded zone. So niobium is allowing ferritic materials that are cheaper, having a very good performance in welding and replace other materials.
Also, this is very nice, guys, for you to know about niobium as well. So, Kai, is there any other applications and which niobium plays like a significant role and enhances the properties of this in specific scenarios, just like welding and extreme high temperatures? What do you have to share with us more?
Yes, I think by now people understand that niobium is present in almost all applications and we have so many more benefits, but I think that's an opportunity for us to talk in another episode. What do you think, Maurice?
I think that can be definitely a good point for us to talk about the future trends and also the questions that the world has to solve right now. So thank you, guys. Watch out. And this is the Niobium Podcast, the place to talk about niobium technology, brought to you by CBMM, global leader of production and commercialization of niobium products. Thank you very much and see you in the next episode.
Bye, guys. See you.